Child in my arms, my son. Lord be with you. And welcome to worship on this Christmas Eve with Our Savior's Lutheran Church of Faribault. It is good to welcome you to this service of prayer and praise and thanksgiving on this most holy of nights. Thanks for joining us. If you've never discovered us before, we're glad that you're here. And we hope that you'll continue to find your way to Our Savior's during this pandemic time. And after these days are over, we hope that you'll find your way to our church too. If you'd like to find out more about the church, just give a call to our office, reach out to us on our website. We'll be glad to follow up and have a chance to visit with you as soon as we possibly can. And also please know, for those of you who are members of this church who have been faithful for so long, we are grateful for who you are and for what you do, and we want to wish you a very Merry Christmas. Just a couple of things to share with you. One really bit of good news. In addition to all of the ways that this church is generous, one thing stands out right now. Just a few days ago, $3,000 worth of gift cards were able to be delivered to people who rely on social services in this county. Thanks to Brendan Cox and his wife Krista, who prepared and put together that whole process, those folks are receiving Christmas gifts that they wouldn't have otherwise had. So thanks to you, too, for your generosity. Now, it is Christmas Eve. It is time to celebrate. Some words of thanks need to be shared. First, with all of our musicians. They recorded in different places at different times, but Brendan has sewn them all together as our videographer and as our producer, and we're grateful for that work that he's done. Thank you, musicians, especially a word of thanks to Dwayne Wee, who is with us in person tonight. Also, we want to say thanks to all of our readers and all of those who work behind the scenes to make this Christmas Eve service possible. A couple of things. Later on in the service, you will be invited to light a candle. I hope that you might have one at home. If not, maybe you'll go find one right now. And during the course of the service, you'll be invited to light a candle as together we sing Silent Night, that wonderful song. We wish we could do it here in the sanctuary, but it's just not possible. So we're doing our best to recreate it as well as we possibly can. One of the most important parts of that song will be the family of John Matthews. John was a pillar of this congregation for a long, long time and a significant citizen in this community and especially in the deaf community. He taught at the School for the Deaf. He was a man who advocated for people with disabilities, and he was just a wonderful man. His family has had the tradition of signing Silent Night on Christmas Eve, and they will share that with us again tonight, a gift that will be beautiful. So, again, thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for all of the ways that you show the love of Jesus in your lives. My hope and my prayer is that you will have a Merry Christmas, and on behalf of the staff of Our Savior's Lutheran Church particularly, Merry Christmas. God's blessings.
We light the candles of Advent. Our living God gives hope. Our forgiving God brings peace. Our loving God promises everlasting joy. Our ever-present God is love. Now our waiting comes to an end. Now is the time to celebrate Christmas. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. We will sing to the Lord. We will bless God's holy name. Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. Jesus Christ is born. Come, all ye faithful, worship the Lord.
Oh, This reading from the prophet Isaiah promises that God will bring light to the darkness of this world. A child, the Son of God, shall bring hope, peace, and joy now and forever. From Isaiah 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as the joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace. For the throne of David and his kingdom, he will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here ends the reading.
96 invites us to praise to the Lord of heaven and earth. May these words encourage you to lift your voice and sing. Psalm 96. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it. Let the field exult, and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord. For he is coming, and he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness, and the peoples with his truth.
Thank you. This portion of the Apostle Paul's letter to his assistant Titus might be described as the Christmas message in one sentence. The God of grace has appeared in the person of Jesus Christ, bringing salvation to all. This is Titus 2 through 11 through 14. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all inequity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds.
Christmas Gospel comes from St. Luke, the second chapter. Listen now to the story of the birth of God's Son, Jesus, from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped her in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In the region, there were shepherds living in fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to the God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors. Thanks be to God.
Holy Child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. O come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. Amen. Dear friends, grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, the child born in Bethlehem, the gift of God who lives in our hearts. It seems that there was a family that had a special holiday tradition. Each person, starting with the youngest, would open their presents one by one so that everybody else could see what was received, and so that a proper thank you could be spoken to the giver. Despite the realities of the COVID pandemic, the family decided that they would continue the tradition this year, but they would have to do it on Zoom on their computers. When everybody got the technology straight and everybody was online, the youngest person on the screen, a four-year-old little girl, opened her presents first. She was precocious, she was very verbal, and she had been practicing all week long saying thank you, thank you. She opened present after present and said thank you for each one, and finally she got to the present from her grandma. And grandma said, "Sweetheart, now that you are such a big girl, I wanted to give you something that you really need." After the present was opened, there was a long silence, and the little girl actually started to cry. And her mother said, "What's the matter, honey? Don't cry. You're doing such a good job." And the little girl looked up at her mom and said, "I don't want to do this anymore." And her mom said, "I know, sweetheart. Doing this by computer on Zoom, it's just not like being in person. It's not the way we want to do it." But the little girl replied, "No, mommy, that's not it. You told me that God always wants me to tell the truth, right?" "Yes, of course," her mom said. "But why are you asking that question now?" "Well, I was hoping that Grandma would give me the dolly I was asking for. So if I have to say thank you for these underwear from Grandma, won't God know that I'm lying?" What would you have said? I probably would have been speechless for a moment or two. Or maybe I would have quoted the contemporary philosopher Mick Jagger, who famously said, "You can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you might just find you get what you need." Never in my life did I imagine I would be quoting the Rolling Stones on a Christmas Eve. This Christmas is different, of course. It's not like any other Christmas that we have lived. There are so many things that have changed. There are so many things that we deal with that are unusual and unexpected. This Christmas, inspired by all of those things, I have a question for you. In the midst of these crazy times, I wonder if you have allowed yourself just to stop for just a minute and think about what you really need this Christmas. What you really need. As a parish pastor, God has given me the extraordinary privilege of being with people at many holy moments in life. At the birth of a newborn, at the death of a loved one, countless other times where people were in profound need. It was just a short time ago that I was visiting with a woman from our parish, and she was talking about the challenge that she faces these days because of her dad's confinement to a nursing home and because of his Alzheimer's. It has been a very difficult year, especially with the complications of this COVID-19 pandemic. As we talked, I recalled a visit I once had with another woman, a woman who was also losing her memories to dementia. While in the early stages of her decline, this woman recognized what was happening. And from that point on, she made it a priority to share her stories with her family, with her friends, with anybody who was listening. It was vitally important to her. You see, she wanted someone to receive the legacy of her life and to remember the lessons that she had learned. Anyway, It was just before Christmas when I visited her to bring her the Lord's Supper. And you got to realize that this was a few years back when parish pastors could actually make calls on their people in their homes. After we shared the sacrament, we talked for a long time. She brought out the Christmas cookies and the hot chocolate. And she said, "Pastor, I don't even dare to use my stove anymore. I don't even warm up a can of soup. All I do is use my microwave. I'm afraid if I use my stove, I'll burn my house down." And she said, "I used to be such a great cook, a wonderful baker." And then she talked of the cookies and the candies that she had made, and she described the feast that she had lovingly prepared and served for her family. She thought back to those better days, like some of us are doing right now. Anyway, while talking about Christmas, she almost whispered when she took me into her confidence, and she said this, "Pastor, my husband and my kids expected me to do something special for them every Christmas. I had to make them lutefisk. It was our tradition. They all said it was the best thing they had ever eaten. That's what they told me. I was known for it. But me, I didn't like the looks of it, and I never tasted it. But because my family wanted it, I felt like I just needed to give it to them." Anyway, that wonderful woman in a moment of great clarity said, "Pastor, I think about those days when I was a young mother. In those days, we couldn't give our children what they wanted for Christmas every year. We simply couldn't afford it. But we always tried. We tried our best to give them what they needed. And what they needed was love, and we had plenty of that. You know, Pastor, I've forgotten many things, but one thing I hope I never forget is the best gift you can get for Christmas is something that you really need. I hope I never forget that." Dear friends, it is Christmas. And I wonder, do you know what you need? I hope you haven't forgotten. Once upon a time, a long time ago, a loving father looked at his children. And then that loving father acted. That father loved his children so much in fact, that he gave them especially exactly what they needed. He gave them a gift that would meet all their deepest needs, their hopes and fears for all the years. That father loved his children so much that he decided to give them a special gift. You see, in those days, in that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel sent by the Father stood before them, and the glory of the Father shone around them, and the shepherds were terrified. But the angel said, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, Christ the Lord." Dear friends, have you been thinking about what you really need? A wise author once wrote, "If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need was salvation. So God sent us a Savior." Dear friends, it's Christmas, and God says you need salvation, a Savior. That is what you need. And thank God, on Christmas, that is the gift that God gives. But if you're like me, and you probably are, you may not always know exactly what you need, or you may not be willing to admit it. Sometimes you might actually delude yourself into believing that you don't need what God has to give. But if nothing else, This pandemic has taught me, and perhaps it has taught you, that when we face the realities of of what's going on in this world today, we come to understand what it is that we truly need. And I'm here to tell you that I believe in this very moment, in this moment of our great need, God acts. Having said that much, tonight I have another question to ask. I wonder what you might do with the great gift that you've been given this Christmas. How will you respond to the challenge of having Christ in your life? Are you willing to respond to his call when you are needed? Are you going to give what you have to give by sharing the gift of Christmas with someone who needs Jesus as desperately as you? Well, think about that question for a moment. And if you would, let me tell you one last story. It seems that shortly before Christmas, a young couple received some marvelous news. They found out that they were going to be able to adopt a new baby. The couple arrived at the adoption agency to receive that baby. They had been on the waiting list for such a long time. They had been interviewed and scrutinized in every possible way. Now, at last, their hopes and dreams were to be fulfilled. They were going to experience the joy of their own Christmas miracle baby. Arriving at the office, they were led up a flight of stairs. And after a few minutes, they heard someone else climbing the stairs. They guessed it was the young woman whose baby would be adopted. The woman who was responsible for the adoption, for all of the arrangements, she stepped from their room into the next room. Only a wooden door separated the two. The young couple listened carefully. They tried to hear what was going on. They heard a muffled conversation through the door, and minutes later they heard footsteps on the stairs as the young mother left. They couldn't be sure, but they thought perhaps they had heard some crying. Shortly thereafter, the social worker in charge came to the couple and brought them to the next room. In a little crib was a 6-week-old baby boy. And on the table were two envelopes. One of these, addressed to the new parents, contained a letter thanking them for providing her little boy with a home, with something he really needed, and acknowledged that under the terms of this adoption, that each would never know the other's identity. Then there was another request. It was this woman's wish. It was what she needed. She asked, would they allow their new son to read the other letter on his 18th birthday? She assured them that she had not included any information about her identity. And as the story goes, the couple honored her request and entrusted the letter to their attorney so that one day the young man would read the message which his mother wrote on that day. She wrote it with a breaking heart and out of love. She gave him to a new family. She gave him what he needed. You know, I wonder what she wrote in that letter to him. I wonder if I had to say all I feel and about all the love that I have for one of our children in just a few precious words, what would I say? I would have no time for trivialities. I would want to say something that really mattered. I would want to say something profound. I would want to tell my child what life was really all about. I would want to state clearly what was absolutely essential for my child to know and to understand, for my child to believe in and to hold on to, something that they really needed. Dear friends, it's Christmas Eve. And because of our current circumstances, I have thought long and hard about what I want to say. And so, tonight, hear this. The Creator of heaven and earth, the God who was and who is and who always will be, gives you precisely what you need. God places his only Son in your arms to have and to hold. And as God does so, You are receiving the most valuable gift ever given, literally the gift of God's presence in your life now and the promise of life everlasting when your life on this earth is done. And the amazing thing about it is this. When Jesus was old enough to understand what the gift of his life was all about, that his Father had given him to this world, able to appreciate what his Father had to do, Jesus willingly and freely gave his life one more time for you, but this time through death on a cross. And why? Well, because whether you believe it or not, whether you think that you deserve it or not, it's because you need this gift. And the gift is yours. I hope you never forget that. The baby Jesus, who grew to be a man, who laid down his life for you as a gift. He's the gospel truth in the flesh. The Christ child, Jesus, is the Christmas gift you really need. Now, let me conclude with apologies to the poet Clement Moore and to all the poets who use verse and rhyme to tell truth. I would like to leave you with these words. It's the night before Christmas, 2020 the year. We are looking for hope in the face of real fear. Many things are so different since our last celebration. Unrest and division are a part of our nation. This virus named COVID is taking its toll. We need a reprieve from this dark night of the soul. Cut off from connections, discouraged and blue. Oh, where are the answers to help us pull through? This isn't the first time. It won't be the last. As we look to the future, we remember the past. On a night long ago, both silent and holy, God decided to act in a manner quite lowly. A virgin named Mary and her intended named Joe, to Bethlehem town they were ordered to go. She carried a baby God placed in her womb, who one day would die, but would rise from the tomb. But first he had to be born. God with us he'd live and teach us to love, demonstrate how to give. His name, it was Jesus. We rejoice in his birth. He gave us his life. He showed us our worth. Although not together, we all are agreed. In difficult times, it's a savior we need. And that's what God does when God gives us the Son. So lift up your hearts. Merry Christmas, everyone. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin. Joy. chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet dreams of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let's all
Let us pray. God, enfold me. God, surround me. God, in my speaking. God, in my sleeping. God, in my waking. God, in my watching. God, in my hoping. And now this night, O God of love, you have come. You are here to live with us, to be with us. Thank you for being here and giving us what we need. Thank you for helping us in every part of your of our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love, hear our prayers on this amazing night. As you have come to be with us, we pray that you might be with so many others who do not have what they need. Those who don't have enough food, those without homes, those without family. Come and be with them. Give them others to provide for what they need. Come with your presence and be near them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love, you have made this holy night shine, yet many feel that they are walking in a dark place. Tonight we pray for those who do not have hope, for those who feel that life has no purpose, for those who are lost, who are feeling without faith. Put a glimmer into their hearts, a glimmer that glows into a bright light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love, on this night, Mary gave birth to a new and holy life, a newborn named Jesus. We pray this night for new parents, for those nearing the birth of their child, for those who are sick and afraid their life may end soon. And we pray for those who have recently lost those they love. Surround us all with your hope and with comfort on this holy night. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now in this moment of silence, we bring to you the other needs that are deep in our soul. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
In just a moment, you'll be invited to sing Silent Night, that song that we love so much. If things were like they usually were, we'd be here together in our sanctuary. We'd be lighting candles and singing that song together. But what I would invite you to do is to find a candle and to light it in your home. Also, as we celebrate this song tonight, I'm glad to say thank you to the family of John Matthews. John, a member of this congregation, a person who was bigger than life in this community, especially in the deaf community, has died just this last week. And so his family will sign Silent Night, as has been their family tradition for many years. As they sign, as we sing, if you're able to light a candle, please do, as we celebrate the birth of Jesus once again.
We pray our Christmas prayer. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day wake to the brightness of his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. and receive this benediction. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now on this night and always. Amen.
Out of sight. yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. One day soon our troubles will be miles away. Soon we'll be as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us will be near to us once more. Someday soon we all will be together when the fates allow. So hang a shining star upon the highest bough and have yourself a merry little Christmas now. Soon we'll be as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends will be near to us once more. Someday soon.